The other days, a few weeks ago, I had a practicing session on clavichord with music of Swelinck. It's a composer that's really close to me. I think he's unbelievable. It was a starting point, or maybe not starting point, but he kind of led to a kind of European international organ school. He's the father of all organists, including J.S. Bach. So the polyphony used, and especially in the Ritz et Carm, going to point to some quotes or some questions that we got there, are simply mind-blowing. And but of course, my clavichord is a much later instrument compared to Swelinck. But that's not what this video is about, but the questions are related to that. So you had Sam asking me, what about authentic tunings here that I'm using, if I could do some videos about that. And Jeremy pointed him to some or one video that I did a long time ago when we were diving into C.P. Bach's book. And also I was preparing with the recording of the partitas. I'm going to do those again, by the way. They've been recorded on YouTube. I have recorded those for release on vinyl and then on CD in 2017. But then came the whole decision actually to do the temporary reconstruction more seriously. And as much as I love the partita recordings that we did, or that I did back in 2017, I want to go into that another time, a new time, a second time, or a third time, actually, if you consider my YouTube recording to be the first, because there are some cool things with tempo, and I need to learn more. It's very complex, the Bach partitas, because they combine a certain reference to French dances, but not really in the original form, so it's a little bit modified, but that's for another time. I get the question sometimes also, what about the Bach dances and tempi? And I will be using Czerny also, not maybe to follow him, but be often as an inspiration. It's in some instances pretty close to Quant's, but I'm digressing. So this is about the temperament. Also further on, cannot pronounce his name. You can change that, guys, in your YouTube settings, or you go to your Google account and you just change your name so I can pronounce your name if you ask a question. Beautiful piece, just curiosity, what tuning system temperament do you use for your clavichord? Do you vary it? Well, those two questions are very interesting, and though I have answered more or less the first a few years ago, I don't mind answering it again. Especially the second one is interesting because my point on temperaments back in the days was a little bit, how surprising does it sound, provocative, by applying actually what appears to be the last temperament that Werkmeister proposed. And if you are in this a little bit more, if you come here from the early music or from harpsichord or clavichord playing, you will know Werkmeister, of course, instantly. He published a few temperaments, like Neithardt in those days as well. Very influential people. They were all theoretical writings. I'll come back on that in a second. But the last, when people refer to Werkmeister, is most of the times one of his earlier system, when you have an unequal temperament, which means that if you divide the difference between tuning 7 octaves or 12 fifths, is correct? The last note doesn't match, so you have to find a system in which you bring the fifths back, but it sacrifices the purity of the temperament. You have to go either for a few keys that you can play in purely, and then the others are unusable, like in mid-tone temperament. Also, there you have a variation, which is not so easy all the time because it's like a system in progression, but you leave out then, for instance, a flat major or F sharp major or keys like that. You can never use them, E flat minor. But of course, when musicians evolved in keyboard playing, they wanted to play in more keys, and so the tuning of the temperaments evolved with them, sometimes before, sometimes later. And so one of the issues with temperaments is that it's good to talk about it as long as you don't propose as an early music musician equal temperament, because then the same thing happens as when you propose whole beat to a solution for metronome readings. And not kidding, this is not on the table. And the reason for that is, I believe, very silly and very, and at the same time, very easy to explain. It wasn't a thing in the 60s and the 70s when the early music movement was born, and they had to diversify themselves against, like, reposition themselves or regroup, if you want, against the other group, which were the pianists and the mainstream performers, who, of course, used the piano tuning, which is equal temperament. And, of course, everything they did was wrong, and so we went there in a field where we had some differences installed. Not researched, but installed. And so temperament was one of those. It's like, and people in the early music movement kind of identify themselves with unequal temperament. And equal temperament is for the pianist and for the mainstream musicians. So the question is if that's correct. And it's, of course, a field where nothing is black and white, like in metronome marks, where just, I mean, you can play it or you cannot play it. And then if you cannot play it, statistically speaking, like in so many, so high percentages, so many numbers of metronome marks that you can never reach or don't make any sense. And it's obvious that that's a solution. With temperament, it's different. You have harpsichord tuning, I believe, temperament. You have clavichord temperament, organ temperament. But people generally don't talk about it really straightforward. For instance, I've been told that the Vo Tempri de Clavier recording of Gustav Leonhardt, I talked to the guy who tuned his harpsichord, and it was tuned in equal temperament. Even with some other names, I will not name names because they're still living. You have pretty advanced. So in the 80s, it was not possible anymore to do that. Maybe a little bit lower in the 90s. Certainly not. And so what musicians asked and still today ask, like, give me a temperament that provides possibilities in all keys, because that's you need to do when you go to the Vo Tempri de Clavier. And I'm coming to the point, do I retune my clavichord depending on the pieces? No, never. And the reason for that is you will when you talk with musicians playing on a harpsichord or a clavichord, they will answer you probably the same. If they don't, they have not so much experience, I would say, in tuning. And I know what I'm saying right now, because when you retune your instrument, every time you play a new piece, first of all, it will cost you like a lot of time. But the main problem will be that your instrument becomes kind of unstable. A string is stable once it's set in a certain position and you leave it there. So adjustments need to be made. Temperature is changing, humidity especially is changing, and though the clavichord is a very stable instrument, you need to adjust, but you bring it back to what it was about. So when you would retune your instrument according to the tonality you're playing in, then you would not do only, not a big favor of making use of your time in a very economical way, because, I mean, obviously you're practicing, but you're actually more tuning than practicing, but also you don't do a favor to your instrument either. It's not very good for the instrument, you know, damaging it. Though if you have much difference in tuning, if you go from mean tune to equal temperament a lot of times and you switch between those, there are some strings, there are some tones, some notes that you need to adjust quite a lot. And that's not good for the string, because it's like pulled over the bridge and all these little nails, you know, I don't know the name in English. So definitely not do that, and certainly not me. That comes to my solution for my tuning. What tuning do I use on the clavichord? If you have to play in 24 keys, Wegmeister, in that very rarely quoted last, it is actually and it was published 1 year after his death, where he says, like, yeah, a bit reluctantly, I would say, he says, when you really want to play in 24 keys, yeah, of course, then you don't have any other choice than to tune every fifth 1/12 too small. Well, that's a textbook definition of equal temperament, and that's 1707. By the way, equal temperament was, of course, known hundreds of years before. It's as a theoretical concept, of course. It's the easiest of all temperaments to invent. I mean, you just divide the difference of that stupid, we say it in Dutch, pittoresque comma. I don't know in English. Would make a fool of myself if I tried. Anyways, and you divide all the fifths, and you give all fifths just as much punishment, I would say, in purity, to just fix the problem. And it's so simple that as a concept, it was known, of course, much earlier. But when keyboard players went into their territory and they wanted to play in 24 keys, yeah, then you don't have another solution. And I came to that when I was practicing the partitas. I know that my clavichord back in the days was tuned in. I had a system which was actually taught by Pat Potvliegen, the builder of my clavichord. By the way, he is an exceptional tuner. I come back to that in a second, what his solutions are. I mean, I trust he will not listen to this video, and I'm just kidding. But I was tuning in a kind of easy tuning where you have six consecutive fifths tuned a little bit lower, and then the other pure, and then you do just a little bit here and there to make the thirds acceptable, to make the fifths not too fast. And so you have a tuning that, if you are not very familiar with tuning, it works. It gives you the possibility of, it's a kind of, if I'm not mistaken, kind of Rameau, even Valotti kind of tuning, but it's actually also like, it's not very nice. It doesn't give you any benefit. But I was using that when I started to practice the partitas. And what happened was, Bach is like a 19th century composer in this sense that he's modulating all the time. It's unbelievable. One time you are in A minor, and then you are like in a very remote key. But what happens is, when you have complex structures, nothing really happens. Once you have full chords, then temperaments are... are patience. You can use then a lot of unequalness in intervals. But when you have parts with two voices, well, left and right hand are completely independent, and you enter a territory where inevitably you have quarter note intervals and fifth intervals, also in reverse. And not only very close to each other, but with an octave in between. So on one part of the keyboard, you're playing one voice, the other, you play the other voice. And there are fifth and quarter note intervals that you have. Once you're modulating, those that were pure in one version suddenly becomes very much out of tune. Because even in a very nicely set, unequal tuning, you have a difference in fifths, of course, it's the thirds as well, but the fifths especially, and there's where the problem started for me. I was stretching those intervals constantly because it's ugly, guys, when you have a two-voice part perfectly in tune in the fifths and the quarter note intervals, and then you modulate, and then suddenly it becomes out of tune. That's what you hear when you come from a perfectly tuned interval. And so this was, for me, unacceptable. And I couldn't get my mind around the fact that was intended by Bach. I then came into contact with Willem Kruisbergen, who is a harpsichord builder living in South Africa. He published like an online book on temperaments where he just collected all the sources that he knew and just, you know, chronologically put it together and made a point like, listen, if we read this evolution, then you have to place a Vaut-Tempérité clavier close to the Vaut-Tempérité harmonia, which is from Werkmeister. How surprising is that? Certainly, if you know that Walter, Bach's nephew, went to Werkmeister, I believe, in 1704. I guess who gave him the hint. But anyways, that connection is obvious. And so the stories of the circles and the ornaments, and you have there this secretly hidden tuning, which, by the way, I don't understand that tuning, and I've talked to many people that don't understand, but we like those stories. You would be surprised how many organs are tuned in that kind of fantasy, because it's like completely ridiculous. I'm sorry to say it. I admire the invention, I admire the system, but that Bach like tried to do something there that was lost forever, and we saw this solution to the mysteriously Vaut-Tempérité clavier tuning. I mean, come on. But the story sticked. I mean, even in many tuning apps, you have that Lehmann tuning right today. But anyways, I don't want to say anything negative about that. Everybody does what he wants. Matter of fact is, if you have 24 preludes and fugues and you want to play them at your instrument, you choose a tuning that enables all of those. And if you don't go for the Wagmaster 1707, then you have to go for an unequal tuning, but in a very advanced way. And what I practically do is actually following the advice of C.P.E. Bach, where he says, and also that quote is used today, solely from the perspective, we don't tune our instruments in equal temperament. We don't do that. And if you read that quote for C.P.E. Bach, I'm quoting from memory, the link that Jeremy gave, of course, potentially leads to that video, but I will check. I'll link some videos in the description box here. But when you take that perspective, then C.P.E. Bach says, like, you tune your instrument in a way that allows you to play in all keys, evenly pure, where most fifths are a little bit too slow or too small. And then, of course, people jump on that and say, didn't say all fifths, did he? No, but he said the majority of the fifths. And so my question then always was also to people when I talk to tuning, and I'm not the expert in tuning. I'm just a very practical guy. I want my instrument to sound well, and then it's okay for me. My question was like, which fifths are then impure and for how much? Because what's a majority? What are most fifths? It's not eight. Most fifths is 9, 10. Let's say you have 10 fifths that you tune a little bit too small. The two left, I mean, they don't make the difference. But what C.P.E. Bach did is very practical. And as everything he describes, if you sit down at your instrument and you start tuning, you tune Bartolt Fritz, by the way, I'll make a video on that, book 1756, dedicated to C.P.E. Bach. When you tune your fifths pure, as Bartolt Fritz later would say, and then you go a little bit to the still okay side, 1756, by the way, also equal temperament, to the okay side, but a little bit smaller, and you just continue like that. And you work throughout the entire circle of fifths, and when the last note ends in an octave, then you're fine. I check the fifths, I tune a few octaves, I check the fifths over two, certainly for a recording, over two octaves if the thirds are okay, and if they are okay, and they will differ, all of them, because I tune by ear. And when you tune by ear, you have an impurity because the ear is correcting or not correcting for higher, you know, how do you say that, beats when you go up, when you go down. And so you have a kind of impurity there, but it's more or less like usable. More or less all the fifths are tuned a little bit too. That's in my opinion what C.P.E. Bach intended to indicate. So there you have it. I tune my clavichord in Werkmeister 1707, which is close to equal temperament, but I'm doing it in a practical way as Bartolt Fritz describes in 1756, which in my opinion is very close to C.P.E. Bach. And so I don't have different, certainly for the music of Bach, I'm not talking about Zwilling, that should be mean tone, obviously, but for Bach, I don't retune my instrument. I don't think that the Voltemperierte Klavier was intended to indicate or to just dispose of or to just compose pieces in different tonalities with different emotions. I don't think that was a thing. You have certain characteristics with Mattheson describes in Scherz tonalities, and I think you still have those. Even Turk describes them. Turk describes them, like, even if you tune equal temperament, it's surprising how different the character still is from E-flat minor to E-flat major, for instance. He says, if I'm not mistaken, quoting from memory, it's your hand position. But what it was about, the Voltemperierte Klavier, was just a book of etudes, so to say, to learn to play, to teach you how to play in 24 keys. That was it. It was a technical exercise, of course. But the quality of the thirds in the Voltemperierte Klavier for me is totally irrelevant, and I don't see anyone who able to explain what the relevance would be there. If you enjoy a little bit of impurity, and I come back to Potvliegen, if he tunes my clavichord, it's not according to the system, it's very close, but he comes from a different perspective. He is going to make F major a little bit better than E flat minor, but I mean, guys, this is a top level way of tuning. And technically, this is an unequal tuning, but it's very close to equal temperament. Would you have a few keys that are a little bit better, a fraction better than all the others? And that's fine with me too. I'm happy when he tunes my instrument. I wish he could do it every day when I make a recording, but that's unfortunately not possible. But for me, practically, that's it. So no, I don't retune my tuning, my clavichord every time I play a piece. And that's my basic tuning that I apply. Okay, that was it for today. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel. Don't kill me for this exposure of my, for me explaining the tuning of my clavichord. And if you don't, then we see each other very soon again. Bye.